I'm very glad to be here to talk about our research. So the topic I'm going to talk about today is polymer-assisted for osmosis for desalination and water reuse. So if you are familiar with desalination or wastewater treatment, and you should be very familiar about reverse osmosis because it is a very popular technology in those areas. Here, forward osmosis, so from the name, so reverse osmosis and forward osmosis, they are related. But forward osmosis is an emerging technology. So currently in practice, forward osmosis only being used as a pre-treatment unit, not a main treatment unit for desalination water treatment. Today, I'm going to talk about the process we are developing. So in our process, we are going to use forward osmosis as the main desalination unit. So first, give some background about Earth's water. So our planet, our Earth, is also called called a blue planet. From the space, if you look at our Earth, it's like this picture shows, it's beautiful blue. Why is that? That's because 71% of Earth's surface is covered by water. So that's why we see that blue. And if we break down the water into water percentage, the Earth's water. So the right-hand side graphs just show you so how much what percentage of different kind of waters make up the whole Earth's water. So 97.5% that's salt water. It has 3.5% or 3% of salt in it. So this water cannot be directed to the water supply. As we can see here, only 2.5% that's fresh water. So this water is a main source for our water supply. But further breakdown into for the 2.5% fresh water, we can see mostly it is ice or snows. That's in the South Pole, North Pole, and in mountains. Only 13% that's groundwater or surface water. So the groundwater is the water in the aquifer, and surface water is in lakes, rivers. The 0.3% of fresh water or 0.007% of earth water, that water is surface water, can be readily accessed by human. So that's the main source, but it's also suffering great pollution. And now we talk about a clean water crisis. As you know, the global population growing fast. During 20th century, so the population has been increased 3 times, from 2 billion to 6 billion by 2000. But take a look at the water supply, the top line. We can see the water use has been increased 6 times. So it's much faster than population increase. So we can say by 2000, to support 6 billion people, we're gonna need about 4,000 cubic kilometer water per year for support these people. And from a UN report, by middle of this century, the water population is going to reach 10 billion. And to support this amount of population, the water is going to be like around 10,000 cubic meter, 10,000 cubic kilometer water per year. So it's about 10 trillion cubic meter water per year. So that's a huge amount of water. If you take into account agriculture use, industry use, because agriculture water use, it takes about 70% of fresh water. And so if you also take into account the pollution, the water we're gonna need for support 10 billion people is going to be way much greater than the water for the least in the graph. So it's also estimated that there will be 47% of population by middle of this century is going to be living in the areas that are suffering clean water stress, because the water, so clean water, the fresh water is not distribute evenly on the Earth's surface. So some area has more water, some area has less water. So that's why people will rushing from the area with less water to the area with more water. So you know that will cause a lot of problems like conflicts, like disease with because of lack of clean water. But in summary, we are really facing water problems. As I mentioned in the last slides, our surface is covered by how much? Like 71% of Earth's surface is covered by water. But we are facing water problem. Why is that? Right? So the reason is, so we should say 71% of Earth's water is covered by salt water. Majority of the Earth's water has 3.5% salt in it. So it cannot be directly used by humans. So what we have to do is to remove the salt. What technology we have to use? That's desalination, right? Let's take a look at desalination. So what is desalination? Desalination, the simplest way is you boil the ocean water, vaporize the water, and you condense the water, you get clean water. That's the simplest way desalination. Actually, it is happening every day. So our Earth is a giant desalination plant. So the the sun, that's a heater. So it heats up the ocean water and vaporize the water, and then condense in the sky, forming cloud, and then becomes rains, come back to the Earth, and collect in the lakes and rivers and underground. That's fresh water storage. So that's desalination. So it's happening every day. However, this process cannot be controlled by human. So when we need water, there's no water, like last year, the drought in Illinois. But sometimes we don't want water, we have enough water, it's two more rain coming, we got flooding. So that's a problem. And we really need a technology to really control the desalination to get a stable water supply. That's the desalination technology we need. So here is the desalination technology, currently the desalination industry. We have the desalinated water now currently supply 1% of total water use currently. So that's basically scale for the desalination. There are three very popular desalination technologies. One is reverse osmosis. It is a membrane-based technology. So actually it's a piece of filter. So this filter has really high density of micro channels. These channels only allows water molecules pass through. So you apply that's the filter or membrane, and you put your ocean water in one side, you apply high pressure, and you push this water through this filter, and all the salt is held back by the filter, only clean water pass through, so you get clean water in the other side. That's the basic mechanism for the reverse osmosis. So this process is pure electrical energy involved. So we can say it takes about 48 kilowatt hour per cubic meter electricity to desalinate 1 cubic meter water, to get a 1 cubic meter clean water. So zero thermal involved, and it has pretty low carbon dioxide emission. So that's why this technology is really, really popular. And it takes about 53% of desalination technology industry. The second one is called a multi-stage flash technology. This technology is a thermal technology, like I said. So the mechanism is just heating the water, and then you get a vapor, you condense the vapor. So that's basically that is. So you the water pass through a heat exchanger, get heated up, and then you pour vacuum at different stages. You get a vapor and condense, you get clean water. So this is very simple, but it's not an energy efficiency. So we can see, it takes a lot of energies and also has a lot of carbon dioxide emission. But it's very simple to scale up. And if you are in a place that you have a lot of energy, the energy is cheaper than water, like in Middle East. So this technology is very popular. And currently, the largest desalination plant operation in the world is this technology using in Middle East. So, but it's soon, maybe next year, the base desalination plant will be replaced, take over by reverse osmosis. But it's going to happen. And third one is called a multi-effect distillation. It's improved technology of MSF technology. So using sprayer or using just the layout the technology. So this improve the energy efficiency. So you take less energy for the same amount of desalination. But it's really hard to scale up. But so this technology only takes 8% the desalination technology. And we also have other like electrodialysis, also some like emerging technologies, membrane distillation, forward osmosis, that's among it. So now we talk about the forward osmosis we are doing. So what is forward osmosis? Forward osmosis, if you remember the osmosis experiment in your middle school, so you have some like a salt concentration, you have some concentration in water. So those solution, the solute, have a tendency to pour more water in to get itself diluted. So the tendency or the force, that's osmotic pressure. So for example, take an example here. So if you have a container, so you one side you fill with salty water, say 10% of sodium chloride. The other side you fill with like a pure water. And in between you put a semi-permeable membrane. This membrane, you know, only allows water pass through. And with a certain time, so the water level will be increased in the salty water side. And the level difference, that's osmotic pressure generated by this salty water. So that's where the osmotic pressure is. We take reverse osmosis in, and you know, we can use this equation to describe both processes. So this equation, GW, that's the water flux, like how much water passes through this membrane at a certain time. So that's basically the water amount. A is the area of the membrane. So delta pi, that's osmotic pressure generated by the salty water. That's and delta P is the external hydraulic pressure you applied. So in reverse osmosis, you push the water through the membrane. So it's from this the salty water side to the low salty water side. So you have to supply a pressure higher than the osmotic pressure generated by the salty water to be able to drive the water through the membrane to this direction. That's called reverse osmosis. So you have to use energy to generate the delta P to finish this process. But in forward osmosis, you have a salty water, you have osmotic pressure, so delta P is zero. So this part is gone, so only delta pi. So we use delta pi as a driving force, driving the water from the low salty side to the high salty water side. So that's the basic idea for forward osmosis. So in the forward osmosis, we can see the salty water, the high salty water with higher osmotic pressure, we call it draw solution. So we can draw water. So we call it draw solution. The other side is called a feed. So you put the ocean water or waste water in this side. That's the water you want to treat. Okay, that's the basic idea for forward osmosis. So as you can see, in forward osmosis, we don't have to use energy to supply the pressure. It's natural there. So that's the advantage. So what is the advantages? Energy, so for reverse osmosis, it has to use electricity to generate high pressure. So it's called high grid energy to finish this process. And for osmosis, it doesn't need this. It can just use like a heat. That's for the further, if after the forward osmosis, if you have to add another process to recycle the draw solution. So we can use low grid energy. So high grid energy, low grid energy, that's only the difference is the price. So electricity is much, much higher, the price. The low grid is just like a waste heat from solar energy. That's, almost zero, so free. So it's there. And membrane fouling, so what is membrane fouling? Membrane fouling is membrane contamination. So you have a filter. When you're doing filtration, the process can get blocked. So with some like organism or some like contaminants. So that's called membrane fouling. We take a look here. If you have contaminants in this water, or so in reverse osmosis, your contaminants is in this side. So in reverse osmosis, the contaminants also get pressurized. So that's why you're pushing everything past the membrane. So it's very easy to get contaminated. But in forward osmosis, so contaminants is in this side. So water, only water pressurized. So that's why the contaminants is not very easily get on the membrane. So it has low tendency of falling. And operation pressure. So reverse osmosis is high. Like usually it's 800 psi to 1000 psi. But forward osmosis is in just ambient pressure. So this the big advantage is, so in reverse osmosis, you have to worry about safety because a high pressure process. So you have to design a high pressure vessel. So that's operation more complicated. So that's another advantage for forward osmosis. Now we take a look at the forward osmosis desalination. So how can if you use forward osmosis as a main unit for desalination, what's the mechanism? So we have a forward osmosis unit. You put your forward osmosis membrane in between, and you running ocean water in one side, and you get a concentrate. So your draw solution in other side, you pour the water this way and get diluted. But you need another process to recycle the draw solution back to the forward osmosis and get the water out. So the water is the final product. That's the basic idea, very straightforward. But where's the challenge for this process? As I mentioned in the very beginning, so it has an advantage. But so far, in practice, forward osmosis is only being used as a pre-treatment unit, and not a mean desalination unit. So why that? So the challenge is here. So you have diluted draw solution. You need this process, that's a challenge. So you need a concentrated draw solution, and after forward osmosis is diluted, and you need another process to recycle, to reconcentrate the draw solution for recycling, and you get the final product of water. So this also need energy. But in some case, we don't care about this. We just take this away. The diluted draw solution as it is a final product, water product. So then the forward osmosis, the advantage is there. So that's good. And for example, we just give an example here. When like a emergency relief technology using forward osmosis, when you have earthquake, you have a flooding, so all the clean water sources get contaminated. You don't have clean water, but you also don't have like electricity available. So forward osmosis will be, the advantages will be, you know, coming up. So you have, what you need is use a membrane and forming a unit. You use sugar or glucose as draw solution. You put everything together, just put it in the water. For like a half hour, it's filled with water, the whole container. That's clean water. What the final product is diluted draw solution is diluted sugar solution. So you can directly drink it for people. And then that's give you clean water and also give you nutrition. That's good. And second example I want to give you is when you have really dirty water or contaminated water, so it's really too hard to concentrate. You can use this technology, like you see water as draw solution. You can concentrate this contaminated water for further disposal, and the diluted seawater, that's the final water product. Because seawater is free, so right, it's available a huge amount. You can just discard it. So if you don't care about this process, so that's forward osmosis. Absolutely, that's good technology. But in most cases, we have to care about this process. We want the water, so we don't want to lose the draw solution, because that's also money. That will increase the cost. How can we do that? So this limited, like a seawater desalination. You every day you're gonna produce 1,000 or 10,000, even 100,000 gallon water, clean water. So you can't just throw waste this draw solution because that's gonna cost a lot of money. So one way we do this, we can select a proper draw solute. So the draw solute will be easily get recycled in this site at a low cost. So for example, we use ammonium carbonate. So this draw solute, if you heat it above some temperature, this will be degraded into gases like ammonia and carbon dioxide released from the solution, and you can get clean water. Or using modified magnetic particles, because these particles are used as a carrier, we can collect it using magnetic field. So that's some like approaches to achieve the for osmosis as a desalination, main desalination unit feasible. Okay, so here is a sample. Example using the ammonia carbonate salt as the draw solution. So the same thing, you have a for osmosis unit that's that's regular one, and you get diluted. The draw solution is the ammonium carbonate solution. You run through this unit and it get diluted. So this diluted draw solution is not directly to somewhere. It's first to a container which is supplied with heat. So the temperature is high in this container, and then the carbon this salt will be tends to be ammonia and carbon dioxide, and will be released from the solution. So this gas will be drained into the draw solution side and recombine as the salt to this salt and recycled in this side. So this process is going to be continuously running. So you get fresh water. But this process, the idea is really nice, but it also has problems. It has problem with this ammonia. So this is a toxic gas. So also very erratic. You have to carefully design the vessel, and also to worry about the safety. So and also when you have to thoroughly remove this gas from the water from the final water product, like must below 1 ppm for drinking water. So you have to build a lot of big distillation columns, so it's really hard to scale down. So for large scale it's okay, but if you want to have a small scale, this technology has problem. Alright, so if you use magnetic particles and as a carrier, so this magnetic particles is in nanometer range, and the surface is modified with some like charges. The charge does supply the osmotic pressure. So if you the same thing, you run through this magnetic particle solution through a forward osmosis unit, you get diluted, but the diluted solution will go through a magnetic field. All the magnetic particles is collected and you get clean water. But however, because when you want a high osmotic pressure, the magnetic particles need to be extremely small. So when running, it's a flocculation will be a problem because particles will agglomerate together and forming big particles, you're slowly losing the osmotic pressure. Based on these problems and challenges, we propose our solution. So what are we gonna do to do the same thing? We're not working on the selection, the best draw solution, but we using polymer to extract the water from the diluted draw solution. So what we do, if you remember the liquid-liquid extraction, so you have something like a more soluble in water or in the oil solution, you mix the oil and but it's dissolved in oil. So you mix those together, and something will be extracted from the oil phase to the water phase, then forming two phases like this picture shows. And you just separate them very, very simply. The same thing. So the polymer we use is, it doesn't like the salt. So only like water. So you mix the polymer with the draw solution together. So you get the water extracted from the diluted draw solution side into the polymer side. and you forming two phases. The top phase is polymer, water, and a little bit amount of draw solute. The bottom phase is concentrated draw solution and a very tiny amount of polymer. So that's, then we can separate the both phases. And the polymer is not like a, it has requirements. So it's not any polymer we're working with our process. It must be low cost because we do desalination. That will be a huge scale. And it must have a low clothing point. What is clothing point? Clothing point is it is a temperature point. Above this temperature, the polymer tends to be in water insoluble. It's insoluble in water. The polymer will precipitate from the water solution. And also, it must be non-toxic. So because if that toxic, that will be a big issue. So based on this requirement, we select the polymer. It is commercially available. It's called Yukon. It's a lubricant, and this is chemical structure of this polymer. So it's available with a price of $2.2 per pound. And it has a clothing point like 60 degrees Celsius or 140 Fahrenheit. So that means above 60 degrees Celsius, the polymer is water insoluble. Below this temperature, it's water soluble. And it is non-toxic, this polymer. It's approved by FDA for the food contaction. So that's okay. And so this polymer working very well with multivalent salt. So we choose magnesium sulfate as a draw solution because can generate very high osmotic pressure and also the price is low. So here is a diagram of our process. We have four unit processes for the whole process. So the first one is forward osmosis. So the draw solution runs through this process and get diluted. Then it is run into the second process, the water extraction process. So it is supplied with polymer. So you mix everything together. You form in two phases. The water is getting extracted. You got a polymer phase and a concentrated draw solution. The concentrated draw solution will be running back to the forward osmosis for recycling. And the polymer phase is mostly polymer and the water and a little bit salt will run through the third process is water polymer separation. And first by a heat exchanger. So sorry, is this wrong? There's an error here. It's a heat exchanger. So you heat up the polymer solution above the clouding point. You precipitate out the polymer. You get the water. So in this phase, you got the solution will form another two phases. The top phase that is water, and the bottom phase that's almost pure polymer. So the pure polymer will run back to the water extraction process to extract more water. And the water phase, that's called a raw water. It has a little bit of polymer in it and a little bit of salt in it. So we need to go run to another, the last process for further purification. We get a pure water. And the polymer collected in this process also put back to the second process. So that's the basic ideas. So we also, what we do is we evaluate those four processes individually, and we get some numbers, and we for the further cost estimation. So, and then we did the evaluation, the first forward osmosis. That's basically the picture shows our forward osmosis module, and here, so we have the module here. The membrane is in between. So one side is running ocean water, the other side is running the draw solution. So you can, and the water flux can be monitored by the computer because this balance is connect to a computer. And here is we use 20% of magnesium sulfate as draw solution here. We use two membranes. One is commercial membranes. It's cellulose triacid membrane. It's called a HTI membrane. The second one is called a thin film composite membrane. This is a very, very good membrane, and it's also widely used in reverse osmosis. Okay, so here is some result. So this both graph is for both membranes. So we test the feed with pure water, so DI, and we just add a little bit salt, so 2000 ppm sodium chloride. This actually is brackish water, and also 3000 ppm that's sea water. So we run through, and as we can see, we get the flux with sea water is around 5 liter per square meter per hour. So we're gonna use this number for the further, for the cost, calculation. And then we go to the second process, the water extraction process. So here is the example. So we have a diluted draw solution, and we also have a polymer solution, so all mixed together. And it's forming two faces, like this picture shows. The top face, that's a polymer face. The bottom face, that is the concentrate draw solution. So here, the bottom face is dyed, so you can see the difference. So one example, if you mix the polymer and the dilute draw solution together, you got a stock solution, it's called. It has 20% of magnesium sulfate. You put a 10% of polymer, and you have water 70% in it. So after extraction, the top phase, that's the polymer phase, it has magnesium sulfate only 0.02%. So that's really, really tiny. It has 60% of polymer and 40% of water. The 40% of water, that's extracted from the diluted draw solution. And the bottom phase is starting from 20%, and it's concentrated to be 23%, and has a little bit polymer and also and water. So this the bottom phase will be back to the for osmosis for recycling. And those conditions also can be estimated by this triangle phase diagrams. Okay, so here the water extraction. The separation for the phase separation, it can be just using gravity, just leave it there. It can automatically separate the both phase, but it needs some time. Also, the composition is not favorable. But if you use centrifuge, we try some centrifuge, and it can achieve this the same better composition with a shorter time. So we use this, we select the best conditions. Like if we use 600 G-force and we run for 10 minutes, or using higher G-force, we run for 5 minutes, that's gonna get the best composition. So the polymer, the magnesium concentration in the polymer phase, in the top phase, need to be as low as possible. The polymer in the salt phase, in the concentrate, polymer phase, need to be as low as possible. So we're gonna use this. We found this is the best result, and we're gonna use this also as for the further cost estimation. The third one is water polymer separation. So as we can, it has a cloudy point. So above the cloudy point, the polymer solution will phase separation, precipitate out from the solution. It's forming the bottom is just polymer. The top, that is water, the kind of raw water has a little bit of polymer in it. So here is some pictures shows how the phase separation goes. Within 5 minutes, it has a pretty good, very decent separation. So the top, that's the water, because also dye. The dye, blue dye, is water soluble. It's only dissolved in the water. So as you can see, at the very beginning, it's homogeneous. Finally, all the dye, the color in the top phase, that means all that's water. So the bottom is clear. So that's polymer. So I also have video. Maybe you can take a look. Just quickly, just go through. You can how the phase separation works. Okay, looks like it starts. So that's the very beginning. So that's a homogeneous solution. And quickly you see the phase separation. Okay. that's about, I can see that the... Okay, so that's 30 second. So you can see the solution originally is homogeneous and clear, and later it's getting, you know, cloudy and tends to be white. And you see the water is moving up. So now it's like 1 minute. The water is accumulate and then moving, popping up. Okay, so now it's about 2 minutes. I will, you know, speed it up. So now it's like 3 minutes. You can see the interface already there. So, but you still see some blue dye in the bottom because that's still some water in the bottom. And if you further going on, that's 3.5 minutes. You can see, you know, the color at the bottom is getting lighter and lighter. So see, now it's like 4 minutes. So already separation almost done. At 4 minutes, and you go, you know, 5 minutes. So 5 minutes is pretty. Now it's pretty nice. And I mean, this actually we can see that this is the separation already done in 5 minutes. So this is the temperature. The best temperature is about 80 degrees Celsius. So that is 80 degrees Celsius. And so. If you wait longer time, you will have the interface will be more clear, and so that's totally 10 minutes. So that's basically the how the separation goes. So okay, so here is some composition result. So originally, it has effect with temperatures. Higher temperature, you will get less polymer in the raw water side. You have also, you know, but the salt is pretty much the same, but it has a big effect on the polymer concentration in the raw water. If you have a higher temperature, you have low concentration in the raw water. So this will be, so this polymer will carry over to the last purification step. So now we talk about the last step, the water polishing. We're using nanofiltration. So we use the water feed is 1% polymer and 0.5% of magnesium sulfate. So the setup, this picture shows the setup. So we build a pilot scale purification setup. So this is the membrane. So that's a spiral membrane, and we have a high pressure pump, and we use a computer to connect the balance to monitoring the flux. So here is some result. We can roughly see the flux average is about like a 10. We tried two membranes. One is EF90, EF270. So the difference between two membranes is EF90 it has a tighter pores, and 270 has a wider channel. So that's why it has a much higher water production. So you see the flux is higher, and for EF90 same pressure, same pressure. The alkalinity has lower, but the concentration in the final water product is much lower for NF90. So we can use both result for the cost estimation. And here is the process flow diagram. So that's basically if you want to build a test bed for the whole process, integrate them together so that's what that is. It's the same as the flow diagram as the process I showed in the previous slide, and it's just with some more like a mixer with some like a centrifuge separator to make sure the process is running continuously. All right, so just give a summary. So we proposed a novel polymer-assisted forward osmosis desalination. In this process, we use forward osmosis as the main desalination unit. And the process, we use polymer, and so that is non-toxic, and the cost is okay, but we propose this new process. And also we selected the appropriate draw solution and polymer pair, because this is very important. And the polymer has to be carefully selected, and also the draw solution also carefully selected, because the polymer not working with all the draw solution. And the third is we evaluated the four sub processes, and it's all working well. We still have a huge space for improvement. Like if we choose a polymer with lower cloudy point, we could save a lot of energy cost, and we could use better membranes, have a higher water production rate, so we will lower the overall cost. So this acknowledgement. So Kishore Rajagopalan is my boss. He come up with the idea, and John Scott is sitting behind, and he back. So he is an analytical chemist. He helped me a lot, like setting up the analytical instrument for the composition analysis. And Vinod Patel, he's an engineer before me working on this project. He did a lot of preliminary experiment. And also I would thank all other people at ICTD who have helped me on this project. All right, thank you all, and I will take any questions. Okay.
So the heat to the test tube was provided by the water bath?
Yes.
Repeat the question.
Okay, so the question is, so the heat separate, so the polymer separation, the water separate from the polymer solution is done in the water bath. Right, so, yeah.
Any other questions?
Membrane process, where is the polymer?
Oh, yes. The polymer, in the membrane process, you mean the last process? The last process, the polymer is the thing we want to collect it, so we don't want to waste it. Because in the third process, in this process, we separate the water and the polymer. The polymer will be back to the second process. And the water phase, because it has a little bit polymer in it, so it's carried over to the last step for the purification with the membrane. So we want to filter out the polymer, and this polymer will be back to the water extraction. And we get pure water. As a water product.
You mean you are using nanofiltration for something?
Yes.
I guess we'll have time for one more question, yeah. And then others can talk to Dr. Wang outside then. Yes?
You mentioned that someone proposed the method that the polymer has high affinity for water, but very low affinity for salt.
Yeah.
So all you are doing is extract water from the raw solution, which is the magnesium salt solution. So I'm wondering why you cannot just use the polymer to extract water directly from the salt water.
That's a very good question. So the question is, so because of we're using polymer to extract the water from the diluted draw solution, why don't we use the polymer extract the water directly from the ocean water? So the reason is, as I said, the polymer is not working with any salt. So the polymer only working well with the multivalent salt. But in ocean water, sodium chloride is a monovalent. So from the, we did the phase diagram, so it's not working well. The phase diagram, you see a lot of salt in the polymer, or the extraction rate is really low. That's why. And second reason is, because in the ocean water, not only sodium chloride, it has other like a toxic salt or some like organism. And if you put the polymer in, so you may carry over a lot of other contaminants. So if you use, but if we select this, the magnesium sulfate, we're first doing the first step to exclude all the salt from the ocean water. So only magnesium sulfate. We know only magnesium sulfate in the draw solution.
I think we probably need a kind of systematic study
right.
of what
right.
kind of polymer to select.
Yeah.
So then just select one.
Right.
I don't need that both.
Yeah.
Now, I probably don't want to talk about the details of
right.
this polymer, which is fine. But I'm wondering if there are certain polymers
mm-hmm.
that have also low affinity for monovalent
uh-huh.
ions, like
right.
on
right.
sodium, and the problem
yeah.
is sodium.
Yeah. Yeah, I believe there is, but we need to take time to find it. But maybe there is.
I want to follow up with this, that the,
right.
have you found degradation of this polymer during the recycling? Degradation.
Oh,
yes,
okay.
The stability of this
oh,
polymer. Because you're going to recycle it
recycle,
over
yeah.
many times.
Right.
So you need to do several cycles.
Yes,
of
yes.
This type to see if the material is
right,
stable
right.
or it degrades during the.
Oh, okay. So the question is. Did we do? Have we done the polymer degradation experiment? So we didn't do that. We haven't done that. So we suppose there is no degradation. So.
Okay. Well, for now we'll close the seminar. But for those who wish to talk to
right.
Dr. Wang afterwards, he'll be in the hall, and we'll see everyone at the next seminar, which will be September 26th. So thank you all for attending today.